is the Big O Show. This is the Big O Show. Pro Scout Bo Marchanti is kind enough to join us on the show to talk a little NFL draft right now. We're going to talk, see what the Dolphins are going to do at five. Bo's been a pro scout for a long, long time and running into him on the road. And I appreciate him taking a little time to talk a little NFL draft. Bo, good afternoon, my brother. How you doing?
Big O, I appreciate you having me on. I'm doing great. We're a day away from this big show, and the way the world's gone with no sports, I think tomorrow night's going to be everyone clamoring to their TV to see how this thing's going to shake down.
Oh, yeah. Dude, the ratings are going to be, Bo, just out of control. Look at Michael Jordan's, doc. It got, the best ratings ever for a doc, almost doubled the second-place doc. So I would imagine this is going to be – and the NFL knows it. That's why they're also wanting to do this. Because they literally have a captured audience.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, they do. And, this the way the world is right now, typically, the NFL, everything they do always falls right. Now, granted, they couldn't have a live version in Las Vegas. They're going to the virtual draft. But nonetheless, anyone who wants to advertise, anyone who wants to get their word out and spread the message, you're going to have to do it, via, NFL Network and ESPN as they broadcast this. And, and people are going to clamor to get those guys on. So, the NFL seems to always fall in the right place. It seems no matter what they do, they always kind of come out smelling like a rose. And once again, as we've come to find out, Roger Goodell stuck to his guns and this draft's going to go forth. They did the same thing with free agency. And hopefully tomorrow nothing catastrophic happens where, a pick is fouled up by some sort of technical glitch. I mean, there might be some, hiccups along the way, but hopefully nothing where things, kind of really go off, the wire a little bit.
All right, so you've been scouting for several years now, and what is your philosophy on injury-prone players? If you see an injury-prone player in college, how do you view him at the pro level? Is that something that you think will continue? Give us maybe you have an example of the good and the bad on all of this. How do you view injury-prone players like Tua?
Well, I think a little bit, obviously, the player, maybe the type of injuries. I'll give you two players. You think of Frank Gore, a couple ACL injuries at Miami. He goes on along to have a productive career. He's one of the top rushers of all time. Vice versa, you look at Cedric Benson out of Texas. He almost played 50 college games, 49 games Cedric Benson played for the Longhorns. He gets to the NFL. He puts one season together for 16 games. I mean, his next highest total was 15. The guy could not stay healthy. So the wear and tear beat up Cedric Benson in college. And when you look at, a guy like Frank Gore, those were ACL injuries. They weren't nagging injuries. It was just, we know running backs run the ball. And sometimes those knees get, put in a place where they shouldn't be and they're bent, and lo and behold, it's just a misfortunate set of circumstances. I don't know if we're heading down the Tua Tagovailoa belt, but, as a quarterback, I'd be very cautious in Tua. I look at him as a fragile piece right now. Mike Tomlin always talked about, availability sometimes is the best ability. And I don't think that speaks more than any other position than quarterback. You need to be there for 16 games under center. So, but I think there's examples, everybody's different, but I think the nagging type injuries are what concern me more than, the freak, ACL, the guy got bent backwards, a la Nick Chubb, just things, sometimes you get tackled the wrong way, but, Tua, he wasn't, he was running by himself when that hip went, so, I think fragile, I think nagging injuries, Big O, are more concerning to me than, some of the, ACLs. I mean, ACLs years ago used to be something catastrophic. Right. But now, we see Adrian Peterson do it. He comes back next year and runs for $2,000. So, I think every player is different. But at the end of the day, I think a fragile guy with the injury history, it definitely affects their draft stock.
So do you take him? If you're, Bo, you're in charge at five for the Dolphins. Now, I gotta also give you the right scenario, too, because it would be unfair. If you only had one pick in the first round at number five, do you take him? But when you have 14 picks and you have three in the first round, two in the second, you might be more willing to take this gamble and you can afford to take this gamble over others. So I got to ask you the question in the Dolphins sense, not in, because I doubt if you were a team that only had one first round pick and that was your pick, number five, I doubt you take Tua, right?
I think teams still would. It's going to come down to how teams perceived his medical evaluation. I mean, if they left the combine and what they were able to do within their own research, I think teams would dig deep, deep, deep on Tua. And then, you know, what it's going to be like bringing him in, where he is along in this process, what the prognosis will be down the road. If your medical staff feels comfortable with it, then you may be elected to. And that's where I kind of think Justin Herbert's kind of, you know, evened up on par with Tua, just because, you know, you have a healthy guy and you have a guy with some health issues. And, you know, that, and that's a diminishing thing around draft time. You know, I taught when, you know, I mean, every time I go on a program, you know, we talk about Tua and itself. You know, if you had a major thing going on with yourself or anyone out there listening to the show, I mean, you know, if you don't like the first diagnosis, you're going to ask another doctor. You're going to get several opinions. And I think when you look at 32 teams, there's going to be 32 different doctor evaluators looking at Tua Tagovailoa. So I think you're going to get a, you know, a wide range of different, you know, responses in terms of how they perceive with going forward. Some guys may elect to say, hey, you know, caution, beware, buyer beware. This could be a tricky. Other doctors might evaluate him and say, hey, you know what? The green light's on. Press the pedal down and let's go with this kid. Because, you know, I look at what the Cardinals did a couple years ago. They moved up and took Josh Rosen. He didn't pan out. They get the number one pick the following year and they take Murray. You know, the NFL, the rookie salary cap, teams can take a flyer on a guy. And if it doesn't work out, look, in one season, you guys moved up in the first round to take Josh Rosen. He didn't pan out, but you can come back next year. So even if they elect to take Tua or any other quarterback, if you think early on that might not be the piece, you know what, Orlando? You just go back into the well next year and hopefully you find the guy that you like. But at the end of the day, if I'm Miami, my doctors say Tua's the guy, he's such a lightning rod and his ceiling is so high, then you go with him. If the Miami doctors say, hey, what, you know what, caution, let's look at another option here, then I think you obviously take Justin Herbert and go from there. Because, they, like you said, they have a stockpile of picks, 14 picks. I doubt they use all those. They'll probably, you know, I think they'll try to absorb some of those and the move up and, you know, jockey around the draft to kind of get what they need and solidify that roster. But, you know, they've had a hell of an offseason. I thought they did fantastic in free agency. They got a stockpile of picks. So, you know, they and even what Flores did last year, I mean, you're talking to me, you know, what he was able to do with the way that team was, awesome. You know, jettisoning off what, some of their top talent, and he was able to accumulate those amount of wins. I mean, you know, I really think the underscoring guy that you could talk about coach of the year for as little of the talent he has, you think about some of the teams that had a lot more talent and failed to kind of deliver. I think Flores did a great job.
Yeah, I thought Flores was a freaking beast last year. Pro Scout Bo Marchante joining us, talking a little NFL draft. All right, so tell me a little bit about Herbert, because, Bo, I don't buy the kid. I'm sorry. I don't see the it factor there. You know, when I watched Russell Wilson, and I remember when he was coming out, most everybody in the pros told me, oh, I love the kid. He'll be a great backup. He'll be a great back. Tony Softly was the only guy that told me that guy starts in this league, but he didn't, like, give me, like, this endorsement like he would be a Super Bowl. He just said, there aren't 32 better than him. He starts in this league. That's the closest I ever got to somebody saying Russell Wilson can be a starter. And look what ends up happening, right? But if you watched Russell Wilson at NC State, and obviously we did because we're here at the University of Miami in the ACC, you saw he was a baller. It was just he was in NC State. And then he goes to Wisconsin and takes him to the Rose Bowl. I just don't see baller in Herbert. I don't see the guy that takes over, the guy that makes the key plays, key drives, big moments. I don't see that. So what are others seeing, Bo? What do you see? How do we talk this guy up? Because I just don't see it, my brother.
I think you touch on a very important thing about Herbert in terms of, you know, being that fiery leader in the pocket, a guy that, like you said, you know, if you're in the backyard playing with your friends, I mean, who's the guy that you want to have the ball in him? Him? Or do you want maybe Tua to have the ball? I don't know. I think Tua might be the guy that, you know, ends up winning that game. For Herbert, I think when you look at him, you know, one, he's a physically imposing quarterback. I mean, seeing him down at the Senior Bowl and standing next to him, I mean, he looks like an undersized defensive end, if you will. I mean, the kid's massive. He's fantastic frame. There's no doubt he's going to stand among, you know, in the pocket, and he's going to be able to see everything going on around him. But he's never played under center, and you say, well, what the, you know, a lot of guys don't, but, you know, translating this in the NFL, I mean, you know, you got to get your feet, your drop pack, and how he's going to settle in and deliver the passes. Those are some of the things I pick up on, or at least I'm concerned about, you know, when a guy in that Oregon Duck offense, and the history of Oregon Ducks quarterbacks has not been friendly. I mean, you think of Mariota, Keeley Smith, you know, all these guys, Dennis Dixon, a lot of fabulous guys that play Pac-12, great college football, but when it comes to that transition to the National Football League, they struggle. But at this point, I mean, there's nobody, maybe, I mean, maybe I think just Jordan Love might, I think, throw the ball better. I think Jordan Love's the best pure thrower. I'm not saying quarterback, but just thrower. And I think behind him, I mean, Justin Herbert can push the ball out, and he can make all the throws. I think he aims a little bit more than what he should. I mean, it's not so much. It takes time for Justin Herbert to get into a rhythm. But again, when you look at his body of work, big-time football, he's had his fair share of games, and, you know, he didn't have, you know, collapsible games where you're like, wow, that's just bad, bad, bad tape. But at the end of the day, I do think what you're saying in terms of a guy that is fiery, a guy that, you know, will ignite a locker room, I think those are the questions. But those are big questions, Big O. I mean, when you think about a quarterback, you want a guy that can lead, a guy that can come in the pocket. You know, I mean, you're a Miami guy. You knew Miami sports as well as anybody. I mean, when you think of one quarterback who was as fiery as anybody, you think of number 13, Dan Marino. I mean, you talk a guy that's going to light a fire underneath your butt if you're not doing the right thing. It was number 13. So, you know, I think of the quarterback, and I always say this, you want your quarterback to be your dad, not your big brother. You want to have a little bit of that fear in him. You don't want to have that friend factor in terms of your brother, your buddies. You want that guy that's going to kind of, you know, put the onus on you to do what you have to do because we have a mission here. And, again, all these guys are going to be young guys doing this, but at the end of the day, I do think that's something you picked up on in terms of Herbert. Can he be that guy that leads and kind of really rallies a team around him?
So, Bo, if Miami goes position at 5, do you like Love at 18? Is that the right pick then for him? Because I don't think 5 is right for Love with, you know, his follow-up season. You know, I was actually running this by one of our guests yesterday, Sean Salisbury, and I could do the same thing with you. And since hell, you do this for a living, you know, we could reverse Jordan Love and Joe Burrow, because Joe Burrow was not good at Ohio State, was not good at LSU at the beginning, and then the following year Brady takes over as his OC and figures the kid out, and obviously he went on to have one of the monster seasons of all time. Well, what if we reverse Jordan Love and he sucked 2 years ago, and then the year he had this year was the one he had 2 years ago? Then all of a sudden or better yet, what if we put Joe Burrow at Utah State, and what if we put Jordan Love at LSU with a team that's about to get 13, 14, 15 people drafted? How does it turn out? You know what I'm saying?
No, you're exactly right. You know, and Jordan Love, I mean, that, you know, the team that Utah State had this past season wasn't the quality of a team that, you know, Love and his numbers struggled, but the team struggled. And I think teams know that. The wild card factor is Jordan Love. And Steve Calhoun, he owns Armed and Dangerous out in Orange County, California. He's been training quarterbacks for a long time, travels the world training quarterbacks. He's been working with Love since a young age. And, you know, I spoke to him several times, trying to pick his brain, trying to find out, hey, where's this kid going to go? And, you know, he's basically said he's heard from 10 to 25. And I'm like, you know, and he's just, you know, that's just shooting the breeze. I mean, you know, wasn't trying to hold anything back. So, I mean, when he says that, I mean, that's a pretty wide range. And, you know, it's team. I mean, listen, tomorrow night is the largest poker game that you'll ever see. I mean, people want to watch, the tournaments. Tomorrow night is poker at its finest. I mean, you know, you have ex-GMs, you know, saying certain things that overvalue or undervalue. Teams are saying we love this guy. And, you know, teams say we don't like this guy. At the end of the day, nobody knows, because the teams don't even know who's going to be on the board. But when I look at Jordan Love, I don't know if he can even get to 18. You know, and if he doesn't get the 18, then I don't know. I think maybe he'll be the last, second to last, you know, pick of the first round, because maybe a team will just, you know, the 49ers or Chiefs will drop out and somebody sneaks up and gets him, kind of like a Lamar Jackson a couple of years ago with Ozzie Newsome making his last pick as the GM for the Ravens. But, you know, I think, you know, from what Calhoun said, I do believe that's possible. And it just takes one team. You know that, Orlando, that one team falls in love with this kid, you know, they could go that route. And, you know, you look at the Patriots sitting there at 23. You know, Drew Brees, how much longer is he going to play? We know they want, you know, Peyton and those guys wanted to move up to get Patrick Mahomes a couple years ago, but Andy Reid beat him to the punch. So, you know, I do believe, you know, just because what I'm hearing, I believe 10 to 25 would be that route. And if that would be the case, if Miami elected to go in any other direction, then, you know, sitting with the 18th pick in the first round, you could say Jordan Love could be a Dolphin.
Bo Marchante, of course, pro scout, joining us here on the program. All right, Bo, you've seen all these quarterbacks. We talked about the top ones now. In that second and third wave, give me one or two guys that if Miami passes up and does not get Jordan Love and does not take, obviously, Tua or Herbert, and you know they're not getting Burrow as it is. So is there one or two guys out there that really intrigue you, Bo, that you look at them, you say, they've got everything that could be a pro quarterback. I'd love to take a chance on this project. Give me one or two projects you like after the four guys that we talked about.
Well, I mean, if we're looking a little later down the route, I'm not going to lie. Yeah, I mean, I think Jalen Hurts is a fabulous prospect. You know, going back to the, you know, you want your dad to be, you know, the captain. I mean, if you take Joe Burrow's magnificent, unbelievable 2019 collegiate season, Jalen Hurts is probably the Heisman Trophy winner last year. So, I mean, what he was able to do in one season in Oklahoma, I mean, he started, you know, where you shouldn't say he started as a true freshman, but, you know, Blake Barnett was there. He started game one in Alabama in 2016. The next game, who comes in, Jalen Hurts, almost kind of like what happened to him in the national championship when Tua came in. But, you know, I mean, he went 13-0 as a true freshman for Alabama, and, you know, they lost to Clemson. They were able to, you know, get back. That's when Tua came in. But I think the world of Hurts, you know, he gets it upstairs athletically. He's as gifted as any of these other quarterbacks that you can find out there. And at the end of the day, you know, he's going to work hard. And I think the way that he handled that national championship game in the benching, and then you know, people out there listening, they're like, how can you, you know, want a guy that got benched in the national championship game? Well, because, you know, we're talking about, you know, a guy in Tua Tagovailoa who people, you know, rave over. But at the end of the day, man, I mean, I don't know if any other collegiate athlete, I know I wouldn't have handled it. I'd have been sulking and pouting, probably throwing things and making
Bo, the flip side is when the kid gets injured like he always does, and then Jalen came in and saved his ass, it also showed his professionalism to a certain extent. I know he's not getting paid, technically, but he showed that he was prepared. Always prepared no matter what. He showed that everything that's going on in the periphery and all the controversy, all that, that he could actually compartmentalize all of that and separate everything, controversy, his emotions, and he had to take the field. You know, it's funny because we're watching The Last Stand and we're watching Scottie Pippen, who signed a terrible contract, and it's his fault that he signed a terrible contract. Yet he wants to blame management, and management is now holding him to his feet to the fire for the contract. And maybe they should have let up a little. But what does he do? He goes to vacation during the season instead of compartmentalizing the whole thing and saying, you know what? It's my fault. I'm an idiot. I signed a bad deal, but I shouldn't screw my teammates over. And Jalen Hurts at no point ever screwed his teammates over. He put his team and his teammates first, no matter what controversy he was going through. You have to admire the crap out of that, because that's something Scottie Pippen couldn't do.
Yeah, and you hit it. I mean, think about Hurts. And when that benching happened, not only did he handle it magnificently, but he did it on the biggest stage in collegiate football, in the national championship game. Now, this wasn't Alabama with some rum-dum school in week one where they're going to pounce by 70 points. This was a national championship game, and he handled it, like you said, and he probably could have came in and handled it the same way. But you talk about a late round flyer, and I shouldn't say late round flyer, but mid round quarterback after we get, you know, the big names out of the way. I'd be hard pressed to bet against Jalen Hurts. And I guess it's a sentimental thing too. I just admire the way he's gone about his collegiate career. And then again, you just look at his body of work. I mean, technically, he's a national champion, true freshman at Alabama, went 13-0 as a starter. Absent of Burrow's season, you know, he would have been a Heisman winner this past year with 1 year in Oklahoma. So at the end of the day, I mean, when you look at his body of work and what he was able to do, I mean, I think Jalen Hurts, for some reason, You know, and granted, we can break down every, you know, I mean, if Jim Brown was coming through the draft, there would be things people critique him that he wasn't able to do correctly. So at the end of the day, I mean, I just think as a mid-round pick, I mean, you got to love the upside in a guy like Jalen Hurts.
All right, so let me give you a couple of names that I'm really intrigued, and I know most of them are going to fail, but I always like picking later guys as a project. Like Jarrett Stidham was one of my guys last year, and the stinking Patriots took him. So let me give you a couple guys. Jacob Eason, and I know he's kind of a statue, but man, he's got a freaking gun. Nate Stanley, I find him very intriguing in Iowa. Anthony Gordon out of Washington State. Our boy here in our backyard, James Morgan out of FIU. Kevin Davidson out of Princeton. Man, I saw him at the East-West, and that's an interesting project to take a gamble on. And then the big kid from Oregon State, Jake Luton. Out of those guys, any of those guys intrigue you?
Oh, you know, I'm going to say Jake Luton and James Morgan. I think Morgan's that hot name right now, you know, the Florida International kid. If you're going to kind of – all the names you mentioned, I think he could be the guy. Luton is another one. I think he should be a little bit more on the – not top-tier guys, but I hope he's a guy that actually gets drafted. I mean, you know, on average, I think, you know, about 11 quarterbacks get drafted a year. So, you know, hopefully he can kind of find himself in that realm and hear his name, Cole. But, you know, he's an intriguing kid. I'm glad you brought him up. You definitely do your homework on these guys as well, Big O. But Morgan and Luton be the two guys that I would say is late-round guys right, on the right. fringe. Yeah. I think those would be the guys that I'd be most excited to bring in.
All right. If Miami has the pick of the litter at number 5 and they get to pick whatever offensive lineman they want – who's the guy Bo Marchante is signing or drafting?
Oh, man. Well, my first inkling is Tristan Wirfs. I just like Iowa guys. They got a proven track record for success. But then, you know, I think Andrew Thomas is special. Jedrick Wills is fantastic. You got Nick Dibecton. I'm probably going to have to go Becton.
You look like the kid in Willy Wonka's factory, and you're looking at all that chocolate, and you don't know which direction to go in.
It's like going, I guess, to the Victoria's Secret show. You know what I mean? You just don't. Everybody looks good. I don't know. Give me any of them. I'm going to be happy. And I'll even drop down a few spots and still get a fantastic player. So that's how I look at it. I mean, I just think this is a nice class. I mean, even, you know, Andrew Thomas, I mean, Austin Jackson, I mean, he's a little bit farther down, still first round talent, but, you know, probably Becton just cause, you know, his upside. Wirfs put on a great combine. I'd have to go Becton. I just, you know, it seems like he'd be the first one off the board, but I think all those guys are quality guys. And I think if Miami was smart, you know, if they elect to take a quarterback in with the 5, which I assume they would, I think it'd be critical for them to kind of, you know, try to get one of these offensive linemen to help out. I don't know if they can get one of these. I mean, there's probably going to be 6 or 7, possibly 8 linemen going in the first round. So they should probably be able to pick one of those guys, not one of the elite ones. But nonetheless, they should get one of these guys if they, you know, get things falling the right way for them.
Well, there's a listener asking if they don't get the elite tackles at 5 because they chose not to. What do you think about Brown at defensive tackle?
Oh, you know, I don't know if Brown will be there. I think Detroit could be inclined to take Derrick
really?
Brown. The thing with defensive backs is, you know, you think about it, I think, you know, Rod Woodson was drafted 4th in 98 and Denzel Ward was drafted a couple years ago, in 2018. So that's a 20-year difference, you know, the highest defensive back coming off the board. You look at Patrick Peterson when he came out in 2011. I mean, I thought he was the best prospect in the entire draft. He went 5th overall to Arizona just because teams are just, you know, the NFL is stubborn. There's that old school way where certain positions should not be drafted in certain places. And you know, that's why you see offensive tackles. You know, they're going to offensive tackles. They're going to kind of take over tomorrow night. And the receivers are such a deep class. They're just going to get pushed down. But at the end of the day, I think defensive back and Jeff Okuda, you know, you think Lions third pick. I wouldn't bet on it. And even if the Giants at 4, you know, they took DeAndre Baker last year, you know, with their last of their 3 first round picks. So, you know, but Derrick Brown would be an ideal fit. I mean, some could argue, and I'm sure there could be a team out there that maybe have Derrick Brown, you know, not ahead of Chase Young by any stretch of the imagination, but you know, he could be jockeying for that second, you know, tag behind, you know, with a Okuda and Isaiah Simmons. But, you know, I don't think it's a bad thing. Miami did some, you know, they, what, Emmanuel Agba they brought in, yeah. you know, this postseason, Kyle Van Noy is a linebacker. So, you know, fortifying that up front. And the thing about Brown is Brown saturates guys around him. You know, he may not be the best pure pass rusher. You know, he's more of an interior guy, but he's able, you know, he has to be addressed. He has to be focused on, and that allows everybody else to flourish. You know, it's come, he's going to be the one doing all the grunt work while the other guys are, you know, getting up to, you know, the stats and all the accolades and get to talk to the camera people after the game.
But you play him in the middle. You wouldn't play him at end.
You could play him at end, okay. But I'm just saying he's not such an edge rusher. You know, people think of Chase Young, the Bosas, you know, you think of this purebred edge rusher. Brown's not that guy. I mean, he's productive, he's disruptive, but he's more of a saturator, I like to call him. He's a guy that's gonna,
So let me ask you. You got Brown, Wilkins, and Godchow. Okay, you got to play the three-man front. How do you line them up? Do you put Godchow in the middle? Because Wilkins and Brown are actually better pass rushers than Godchow.
That makes sense to me.
So if you had those three, Brown and Wilkins would be your ends, and Godchow would be your middle guy, right?
Yeah, I think you'd have to. I don't see any other. I mean, let's say, you know, Flores would think something different, but yeah, I think logically speaking, that would be the route you have to go.
All right. Dean is asking, Lynn Bowden, who I love, where do you think he gets drafted? I'm guessing like third round, but you're the pro. You tell me.
Who was it again?
Lynn Bowden.
Oh, Bowden. Ugh. Yeah, I could say third round. I'm thinking more day four or day three in the fourth round.
In the fourth round, okay.
But again, you know, I mean, it's up to, you know, the evaluators, but I would say fourth round if I had to put money on it.
Okay. All right. Good stuff there. Bo Marchante joining us, pro scout. At five, what are your thoughts on Isaiah Simmons? What do you like about him? Because he seems like the perfect guy for Flores, since you can play him all over the place. But some people don't feel that he might be good enough to play all the time. He's kind of a guy that maybe you shouldn't take this high in the draft. You tell me.
I love Isaiah Simmons. I think he can be a difference maker. And, you know, you think about how creative the Patriots were, and Flores was part of that, you know, being creative with guys and be able to kind of use them in different ways. I think that would be, you know, we talked about Willy Wonka in the chocolate factory. I mean, I think Flores.
Bo, did we lose you?
It's Simmons. But I'm all in on Simmons. I think he's going to be a fantastic pro.
Yeah, no, I'm with you too, man. I think he's going to be absolutely awesome. So where are you watching the draft tomorrow, my brother? Ooh, Bo, did we lose you? There we go. Bo, you there?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I think we lost you, Joe. I'm here.
Go ahead. So where are you watching the draft?
I think we're breaking up.
Yeah. It looks like we're breaking up there.
Okay, I can hear you now.
Okay, so where are you watching the draft tomorrow, my brother?
I'll be home. I'll be home and, you know, in my little room with the TV on and, you know, and just watching the picks come off the board and probably have a beer or two and just enjoy the moment and try to get ready, you know, try to figure out all that I don't know as each pick comes off the board and it shocks me. I mean, I don't know how it is for you, but if we sat together tomorrow night and watched that draft, I might get maybe four picks right. So.
Yeah. Oh, please. That's all of us, dude. Come on. It's like hitting the lotto to try to figure this thing out. Like right after Burrow and Chase Young, we start guessing after that. You know what I'm saying? So I'm with you. And by the way, before I let you go, where do you stand on the one-year wonders? Because we kind of talked about Burrow and Love, and Burrow technically is a one-year wonder, which normally scares the hell out of people like you, pro scouts, coaches, assistant coaches, GMs. Over the years, I've seen you guys get terrified by the guy that only has 1 year of tape, and the Jason Pierre-Pauls are few and far between. So how do you feel about that? Because everybody's in love with Burrow. Not enough people are saying, you know what, it is only 1 year. I'm concerned about that, but it was magical. So how do you look at that?
I think his body of work, and then I think you look at where these guys come from and what the level of competition that they played against. And, so for Burrow, I think that's where he kind of crosses the T's and dots the I's, if you will. And real quick, when you think about a lot of the quarterbacks prospects, everyone right now, when you think about next year's draft, start looking at all the guys that you don't see on the top 15, the top 20 list of projected 21 quarterbacks, because a lot of times, Baker Mayfield was that guy. Carson Palmer was that guy. Cam Newton was that guy. Joe Burrow is going to be this guy. So it seems like every year these guys come up, they're good quarterbacks, but they just kind of, everything kind of just comes, to fruition for them. Everything, the light turns on. And they go. But I think when you look at these guys, one-year wonders, where did they play, what their recruiting was, how did they, go about themselves to get to that point? And I think that's why a lot of teams aren't so skeptical of looking like a guy at Joe Burrow. I think if you came from a small school or a school a little off the radar and you had that same success, that's when you're really scrutinizing. Teams really want to critique you.
Oh, you mean Josh Freeman? Okay, I'm sorry.
All right, here we go. You talk about 1 year wonder. That wheels went off,
I think I had four different scouts that off season, and all happened at Nikki Blaine's. They'd whip out the phone and go, "Look at this throw against Navy," and then I'd look at each of them and say, that was Navy. And he goes, "Yeah, but still, look at the throw." Because he made this throw against Navy where he was running to the left and threw to the right like 60 yards. And that's the thing about Josh. He physically was an absolute – hell, he made a performance here against the Dolphins where he by himself practically beat the Dolphins. And he had guys draping all over him. And it was one of the more – one of the performances of his life that I'm sure – he's going to remember forever. But that's one of those one-year wonders that a lot of people got suckered into, too. They bought into Josh Freeman. I was one of those, too, by the way. I bought into him.
Yeah, and, you never want to do any decision on one play. I mean, that I was going to talk about, Freeman coming back to the National Football League and having, the Vikings sign him, and they end up, throwing the football, 60-some times. The guy was just getting beat up. But, you think of one-year, one-play wonders. You think about Matt Jones on the tight end receiver down at the Senior Bowl. He made that phenomenal catch. Then he goes in the first round of Jacksonville and then basically disappears. So you never want to put tough stock in the one play. Hey, think of one play. Think about how much Jadeveon Clowney's sack against Michigan, sack fumble recovery. One of the most impressive plays. But when you think about that play and what we thought about, as good as Clowney's been, he hasn't been this electrifying, just Von Miller, game-changing, superstar. That play in itself made him the prospect that we thought he might become.
Right, and he never became the sack artist that he was drafted to become. And that's the sad part. And as for Matt Jones, stay away from the cocaine, dude. That might help a little bit. Anyway, all right, Mo, much love with you, brother. I appreciate you taking some time. You are an absolute stud. Thank you for enlightening all of us and dropping the knowledge. You are awesome.
Big O, you're the best, man. Stay safe, and you and Bill, family safe. Enjoy the draft, gentlemen.
Thank you, Bo. You be good, baby. There you go. The great Bo Marchante, man, pro scout, joining us.